Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to talk about how to create an effect something like this. Essentially, this is a fluid or water simulation with a few lights and some volumetrics in the scene, but it's also not being affected by gravity, but it is being affected by some other forces to give it this interesting motion. So to begin with, we need to add a simple fluid simulation, and that's pretty straightforward. So we'll just add an icosphere. And the default is fine. And then if we come up to objects, go to quick effects and say quick liquid. So if we have a look at what that's doing, if we press play, nothing's happening initially. And that's because with the latest version of Blender, we need to bake simulation to some degree before we can see anything. So it's already selected the domain. With a fluid, I should say, you need to have a domain which specifies the area within which the fluid simulation is going to take place. Otherwise, Blender is trying to calculate the fluid for infinity, and obviously that's not going to work unless you have an infinite computer. So if we click here on physics properties with the domain selected, you can see it's already set it up as fluid type domain. If you were creating this as a fluid domain manually, you just click fluid here and then select domain, but it's no reason you shouldn't use the quick fluid because that does do a few other things for you as well. And then under settings, you can select liquid or gas. Obviously, if it was a volumetric effect like smoke, it would be gas that you select, but in this case, liquid. We'll accept the default resolution for the time being. Time scale, you can play with if you want to. The default of 1 is a good starting point, and the CFL number, this will affect the sort of time resolution of the simulation. To begin with, just accept all the defaults, and then under here, click bake data. It shouldn't take very long. You can see the progress down here, and you can also see the marker on the timeline. And once it's finished, we can see all these little blue dots, particles that have suddenly filled in this sphere. If I press play now, you can see they all fall down, and clearly what they're actually doing is representing the surface of our fluid simulation, because this is now a flip or manta flow fluid simulation. And these are particles that are representing the surface. It's a different way of approaching a fluid simulation. The colors by default represent the velocity of the particles. So you can see here they're moving very quickly. Then as they settle down, that velocity changes to a blue velocity. This is not actually what you would see when you rendered it, but this just gives you a quick way to see, is this doing what I want it to do? Now you'll notice we're only getting to frame 50 and then the simulation is stopping. And that's because by default, the cache is set to only do 50 frames. And we'll leave it at that for the moment. So I'll set the end frame to 50 just to keep things quick for the tutorial. Eventually, you're going to want something that will represent the fluid itself, and you therefore need to bake a mesh. If we unclick this, the flip or liquid simulation will disappear, but the data is still there. I'll leave it on for the moment. But if we turn this on, this will now allow us, if we open that up, to bake the mesh. The good thing is you can do that liquid surface simulation, see if it's working in the way you want it to work, and then only when you're ready, you can go in and bake the mesh. You can obviously bake a preview version if you want to, but I'll just bake the final version. The reason you might want to do these separately is obviously because it will take much longer to bake the mesh and the liquid simulation than just one of them. Again, you can see the progress going along down here. You have to have done the liquid simulation in order to be able to bake the mesh simulation. And once that's done, you can see something's changed up here and our domain seems to have vanished. And now you can see we've got both those flip particles and the mesh itself. So I can actually turn that liquid particle system off there. And if we go to a solid view, now you can see what's happening is where our initial object was, our domain becomes a ball of liquid just there. And when we press play, it just drops to the bottom of the domain. And that's fine, but that's not the simulation we're trying to do here. And because we used the quick fluid simulation, you'll actually find that it's already put a material on there, and in preview mode you can see it. I'm going to switch to EV mode as well, because that was what I did the original simulation in. And for the time being, I'm going to use nodes, and I'm just going to add an environment texture just to give us something to reflect onto our liquid so that we can see it. So there it is. We don't want our liquid to fall. Now, within the simulation options, I'm just going to free the data here. If we come down to field weights, there is an option to modify how much a fluid simulation is affected by these different forces. So logically, you would expect that turning this one down to zero should mean that my simulation is no longer affected by gravity. Let's turn off the mesh and go back to wireframe. So we'll turn on our liquid and we'll bake the data. So if I press play now, you can see it's still behaving in exactly the same way. I don't know if this is a bug or as designed, but that isn't, unfortunately, the way to turn off gravity for flip liquid simulation. Non-intuitively, turning gravity down to zero here doesn't have any effect. So we'll put that back to one. There's two places now that you need to change. The first of them is here under the scene options, and we need to turn off gravity here. This is, if you like, the global gravity. But if you just bake at this point, you'll still have a simulation which will fall in a normal fashion. So if I can demonstrate that, if I bake this now, and you can see it's still falling as it was before. And the reason is, if I free the data, although we've removed global gravity, it's now superseded by local gravity, which is by default set to -1 meter per second. So we also need to set that to zero. You have to do both those things. So that's the scene gravity needs to be turned off, the overall gravity, and the local gravity needs to be turned off. And now when we bake it, it'll actually bake more quickly because at the moment, there's almost nothing happening with that fluid. It's just sitting there, as you'll see in a moment. So there it is, and I press play and you can see nothing happens. So that confirms it's just in completely still air in zero gravity. So it just sits there. So we now need to do something with that just to make it a bit more interesting. So what I did was to add a couple of forces. So we'll add a force field and we'll make this a turbulence field to start with. And I'll just put that down there. It doesn't matter too much with the current settings as to where it is, as long as it's in the scene. And we'll start off with the settings that I used. So it's a turbulence force. I set it to plane. I set the strength to 4. I set the size to 2. So the size is how close together the, as it were, wobbles in the turbulence are. And I set flow to 1.5. So this sort of links together the way the different perturbations move. I added some noise at about 2. And you can play around with the seed if you want to try to select a different part of the turbulence, as it were. And everything else was left at default. So if we go back to our simulation, free the data and bake that, and you can see we're starting to get some distortion. We're only doing 50 frames of simulation at the moment, but you can see it starts to move out from its central point. I thought I'd do a little bit more than that. So I'm going to take that force, Shift D to duplicate it, and then GZ to move it up above somewhere. So it's another turbulence force at the moment, but I'm now going to change it to be a vortex force. So this literally is like a whirlwind. I turned the strength quite low, so I set that to 0.01. Inflow I set to 0.25. Noise amount I set to 0.5. And now we'll select the domain and free the data and then bake that. So if we start to have a look at what that's doing, that's now starting to pull it in a circle, as it were. We'll probably need to do a few more frames than that, but I think I'm going to turn the strength up 0.02. What I'm also going to do now is alter the shape of the domain. So I'm going to go into edit mode, just treat it like any other box. I'm going to make it taller and then scale Shift Z just to make it a little wider. Now you'll notice the pre-baked particles have moved around, and that's a little warning that you may need to reset the origin point, that little orange dot of this domain. If you don't, you may well find that that's exactly what happens, that your fluid simulation appears in a slightly unexpected place. Basically, the simulation doesn't seem to take account of origins that are not central to the geometry, but it's easy enough to fix that. If you go up to Object, Set Origin, Origin to Geometry, and now it'll be sensibly placed and things should work. So at this point we'll free the data. We'll come down here and set the end to 150. So we'll do 150 frames and we'll bake. So we'll set the end of our timeline to 150 and we'll see what that's like. So if we look from above, you can see it's somewhat being dragged in a circle. And if it's not enough, we can certainly increase the strength. And you can see it's being dragged vertically now as well. We're still only doing a few of the frames, so it's not rendering all of it. But what I'll do now is come down here, turn on the mesh, and bake that. So if we turn our liquid particles off and we go to solid view, we can have a look at what that's doing now. And you can see that's starting to work. Now this is still a relatively low resolution simulation. So one of the things you will want to do is to increase that. I only went up to about 85 resolution divisions, but you can certainly go a lot higher than that. But bear in mind, it will take significantly longer to simulate. So once you're happy with that, we obviously need to do a few more things like lighting the scene and so on. So let's just add a simple point lamp initially. I had mine at about 1000 watts. So that's quite a bright lamp, but I set the radius down pretty much to zero. So that's quite sharp shadows. This is entirely up to you, of course. Bear in mind, we're using EV, so there are some subtleties to EV. Everything else was default, but I set several different colors. I had a pretty much white lamp, so I've duplicated that one, and I'm going to create quite a red lamp and perhaps one over here that is green, and also have them in different places on the vertical axis as well. So at this point, I'm going to remove that environmental texture and we'll set it to black. But at the moment, our object has got a default glass texture. So if you don't want that, you'll need to change it. So if we go to the shader editor, you can see by default, it's put a glass shader on there. It's even put a volume absorption on there. So I removed that and just put a simple principled shader on there into the surface, of course. You can see how bright those lights are. They might need toning down a bit. I set a base color. We'll have a bluish sort of color there. But I also had some subsurface. So I put the subsurface up to about halfway just to start to create some unusual sort of effects. I've turned the overlays off there, which has removed things we don't necessarily want to see. I also had it set to about 0.8 of metallic. So this is not a, as it were, a sensible material. I just wanted to have something a little bit more unusual. There's not really any color other than this blue on this material. It's just that the lights are colored, and so they're giving this interesting effect. I turned the roughness down quite a bit. You can see it's a more shiny object now. And then I added a texture, which was a noise texture. I set it to 4D, as it happens. And then I added, under vector, a bump node. I took the output of my noise texture into the height of the bump node, and then the output of my bump node into the normal input. I set the scale on my noise to about 42. I then set the distortion to about 2. So this gives you a sort of literally a distorted noise, and you can see it's affecting the surface there. And then I set the strength down to about 0.15, and you can see you just get this subtle variation in the surface then. It just adds additional detail. And because it's 4D, it will change as well as the object moves around. Because it's EV, we can look at this in pretty much real time. And then finally, to add some volumetrics to the scene, I just added a cube, scaled it up to include the lights as well, gave it a new material, remove the principal shader and add a principled volume shader, connect that to the volume input. I set that to basically white and I set the density to 0.01. Now if we go to rendered view, what you can see is that the lights are showing in the mist. Now I haven't done anything with the settings in EV yet, and there's a few things we can set up in there to help get the effects we want with the lights. So bloom I turned on, but accepted all the defaults. You could turn on depth of field if you want to. I did turn on screen space reflections because there's not a lot of other things to reflect in the scene, just really the lamps. It was a relatively subtle effect, but you get a slight change around the amount of light reflected off the object in this case. Under volumetrics, I increased the resolution to 2 pixels. So that's going to smooth out the volumetrics quite a bit. You can see that looks a lot nicer, but obviously slows the render down slightly. I turned on volumetric shadows. Under certain circumstances, you can, may just be able to see we're getting a sort of god ray effect with the lamp that's shining here out to here, so that it's casting a shadow. That's because I've turned on volumetric shadows, and I turned the shadow samples up to 32 just to give a slightly sharper edge to those shadows. And then under shadows, I put that up to 1024 for the cube size. Cascade size I left at default, and I turned on high bit and soft shadows. It just sort of simulates a slightly softer light. And that's really all there is to creating this weird little fluid. So the key thing to remember really is that you have to bake this fluid, and typically you're advised to do it as the flip liquid and then switch to mesh. One last little thing, if I render this now, even though EV's being used for the viewport, you can see it takes a little bit longer because it's doing a higher quality render. But you'll also notice we've got this icosphere appearing in here. So what we need to do under here, the object properties, go to visibility and unclick show in render. I've just turned off the overlays, so if we now render that, you can see it's disappeared. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.
So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well, and I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.